The part of the argument is not based on evidence, but on what they consider negative implications or consequences if the science is right. For creationists, there is the fear that if evolution is true, then, in their perspective, there is no God. For global warming contrarians, if things are as dire as the other side claims, then we're going to have to make unacceptable to them changes in the way we live, giving up personal freedoms and so forth. So there is this ideological component to it. And finally, and this is truly not an exhaustive list, there are similarities in framing and rhetoric used by anti-evolutionists and global warming contrarians to present their views to the general public. Now, in looking for the last year or so at the global warming controversial issue, thinking about the evolution controversial issue, at NCSC, we keep being reminded of our beloved pillars of creationism, which have proven so useful in terms of organizing our thoughts about the opponents of evolution. Many of you are quite familiar with this, it's helped your thinking as well. The first pillar of creationism is that evolution is weak science. You know, scientists are giving up on evolution. A surprise to scientists. The incompatibility of evolution and religion is certainly an ideological argument, not having to do with the science, independent actually of the science. And then finally, the third pillar, the fairness pillar, that, well, if you teach evolution, it's only fair to balance it with something. And originally it was balance it with the teaching of biblical creationism. When that failed, it was balance evolution with the teaching of creation science. When that failed, of course, it was balance evolution with the teaching of intelligent design. And when that failed in the courts, the creationism du jour is to balance the teaching of evolution with the evidence against evolution. So we get back to the first trouble. These are independent but certainly interrelated. But we're finding that there are also pillars of global warming or anti-global warming. Anthropogenic global warming is weak science. The science is not there, the jury is still out. I thank my colleague Josh Rosenau, by the way, for this insight. Anthropogenic global warming is anti-capitalist. It is pro-big government. This, again, is an ideological argument against global warming, and parallel in the sense that the second pillar of anti-evolutionism was also an ideological argument. With evolution, obviously, the ideology is religious. With global warming, it's political and economic. The author, Naomi Oreskes, refers to his free market fundamentalism, joined with fear of big government and loss of individual freedoms. In the anti-global warming school, there's also a parallel to the fairness pillar, the idea that teachers, because the jury is still out, we shouldn't impose solutions until there are agreements. Again, I only have 45 minutes and a lot of those are gone. So I have to pick and choose as to what I can talk about this morning. I'm going to talk more about the first pillar and a little bit about the third, because I think these are the ones that are most relevant to science teachers. So how do we question the science? Let's start with the first pillar. A major technique, illustrated by Oreskes and Conway in their book Merchants of Doubt, is to convince the public that science is still undetermined, the jury is still out. This technique was successfully used by tobacco companies during the decades that public health organizations attempted to demonstrate that smoking causes cancer, addiction, heart disease, and other conditions. Tobacco companies claimed that the science is not yet settled on the issue, even well past the time when there was a strong scientific consensus that smoking is bad for your health. So as long as tobacco companies could create doubt in the public's mind about whether or not the science was settled, they could avoid restrictions on their business, such as warning labels, ability to advertise freely, being able to advertise to children, and so forth. This technique was aided by the tendency of the media to provide balance in reporting. You get representatives of one side and the other, or more, to present their views, and I'm not criticizing this. I'd much rather have a newspaper article or a television program presenting more than one side of the view. But the balance doctrine has to be thought about a little bit and used carefully by the members of the media. He would not give an astrologer the same word as an astronomer, even if there were reason to present an astrologer's view in a story. But too often the public is misinformed that the views of a minority, and sometimes this is a very tiny minority, are supported as well as the views of the majority. Even when there's not an active campaign to change the public's mind, as we have with the anti-evolutionists and the anti-global warmingists, just reporting a story with this kind of balance can lead to a great deal of public misunderstanding. In Great Britain in 2002, 53% of the public thought there was equal evidence for both sides of the claim that the measles, mumps, rubella vaccine caused autism, even though virtually all the scientists and medical practitioners, physicians, rejected this claim. Just the fact that the media presented both sides with equal emphasis implied to the public that both sides have equal amounts of evidence, and this is not the case. Certainly not the case with evolution and global warming. The public is not aware that scientists are quite united in their views of the scientific validity of these sciences. Far more scientists accept evolution and climate change than the public is aware of. Now, a major way of creating the perception that scientists are split in their views is to drive a list of scientists who disagree with the consensus. The Creationist Discovery Institute has a list of scientists doubting Darwin's, somewhat over 800 now. Footnote, Google Project Steve. There are enough chuckles around the room that people remember Project Steve. It's still going on. I mean, we've got about 1,100 Steves now, and this is a gift that keeps on giving. The Oregon Institute of Science and Medicine, which sounds quite impressive, but it's basically Arthur Robinson and his sons, has an impressive sounding 30,000 scientists on their equivalent petition denying global warming. Now, the OISM petition is drawn from a fairly random list of scientists, including medicine, engineering, veterinary medicine, agriculture, computer science, as well as climate science. About a third of the 30,000 people, about 10,000 people, the largest category is general science. And all you need is a bachelor's degree or better. There also are questions as to the validity of many of the signatures. Many people have found themselves on this list and asked to be taken off, sometimes with success. But in any event, even if they found 30,000 people with bachelor's degrees or better to sign a petition saying, we don't think global warming is taking place, when you look at the total percentage of people who have received bachelor's, master's, or PhDs, or MDs in science since approximately 1970s, that would be, those people, some of us are still alive, so this would be the group that would be sampled. This is like, according to one calculation, 0.3%, even if all of these signatures were valid, which is certainly a question. And that's, of course, the thing to remember about these claims of substantial numbers of scientists doubting either evolution or global warming. The number of scientists on the other side is minuscule compared to the number accepting either evolution or global warming. The public, unfortunately, tends to hear the media's commitment to balance, which is presenting all sides of an argument as meaning both sides have equal weight, which they rarely do and certainly don't in these cases. I want to talk about another way that the antis, if you will, attack the consensus view. And this is through cherry-picking of data. This is classic in creationism. Carefully select examples that shed a negative light on either evolution or global warming. In creationist literature, you find abundant evidence of this. They are adept at finding an apparent anomaly and thereby challenging evolution through it.